Okay, so we're going to get started. So I'm just going to give a short overview of the whole course, and then Stuart is going to give a lecture on bioinformatics data types. So we're trying to make everything available on the website that's shown there, and these slides are on the website also, so if you want to download them. And the plan is to always have it up there before the lecture. And then after, and we're also trying to capture the screen and record the audio. So, and those will be up also on the website pretty soon after the lectures, usually. So the some practical things. So the lectures will be on Tuesdays and Thursdays, 2 to 4. And unfortunately, they're not going to be in the same location always. Usually it's going to be either here in the Skirball third floor seminar room, or sometimes on the fourth floor, and a few times in Smilo first floor seminar room. But it should be all on the website, so please check it before. Then if you need some help with the homework, there will be, or with anything else related to the course, there will be tutors available every Thursday at 4 p.m. And that's about a 10-minute walk from here. It's on 227 East 30th Street between 2nd and 3rd, on the 7th floor in room 718. There will, yeah, so you can go there if you need any extra help. And you can also, if you need more time than that, you can also set up appointment in smaller groups with the tutors. So homework, there will be, most weeks there will be homework, and we'll post it on Tuesdays. And then they're due on Sunday at midnight. And then you can, the idea is that then, if you have any questions about the homework, you can bring that up and discuss it on the session on Thursdays. So the course assessment, so participation, so we're going to send around the form for you to sign in. And if you're, oh, do you want to send the panel? If your email or name is incorrect, please correct it. And if you're not on the list, add your name. And so I took it from Albert. So if you're not on there, I think you, then you're not in Albert either yet. So please check that. So the course, so participation 20%. Then there will be the assignments, the homework every week, which will be 40%. And then the final will be the exam. So in general, what we want to teach you is a few different things. One is to plan good experiments that can, so, and also connect the designing of the experiments with the data analysis, to think about it as one, so make one design for both how to plan the experiment and how to analyze the data. We want to give you some tools to be able to automatically process large amounts of data that both that you generate and that you can download from the internet. There are more and more large data sets that can be very useful to use in connection with your own data. And then finally, to statistically analyze all this data, both that you generate and that you collect. And the course will only run for 8 weeks. There are 15 lectures plus, so there's 16 occasions. The first one was the pretest. So first, Stuart is going to talk in general about biological data, and then go through Python, so that you'll have tools to so you can analyze data. And then we will move into statistics and other bioinformatics concepts. So it's a short course, so it's good if you try to come as much as possible. Yeah, that's all I had to say. Any questions? Okay, good. So I'll give it over to Stuart.
Okay. All right, so this is a course about data and data analysis. So I'm going to spend a lecture giving a general overview of molecular biology data, data types in molecular biology. Bioinformatics can be defined in different ways, and some of you will deal with different types of data, but the majority of our emphasis these days seems to be on the kinds of data that fall in general definition of genomics, and so that's most of what I'm going to talk about today. If there's a whole separate infrastructure to deal with, say, imaging, informatics, and a separate set of courses to deal with medical data informatics. But when we talk about bioinformatics, we're talking mostly about the kinds of biological data you guys will be generating in the lab and the types of reference materials that you'll be finding on the internet to make sense of data that you generate in the lab. So today, I'm going to focus on the real nitty-gritty, text formats, tag value pairs, some basic concepts of how to interact with a database, how they're structured, how to make a query. A couple examples of specific file formats that I want you to know when we start talking about molecular sequence data, such as FASTA format. Some examples of important public databases that you will frequently need to interact with, such as GenBank. And then we're also going to talk about genome browsers and another specific file format called the BED format, which has become quite important now that we put a lot of our information with respect to the genome. We talk about variants, we talk about proteins, we talk about epigenetic modifications, and a BED format is really common way to communicate information that relates to a genome. Okay, so that's the general outline of what I'm going to cover today. Look, we have 2 hours scheduled, but I don't expect to talk for 2 solid hours, but I'm fine to stop and answer questions or go on digressions if there's something interesting or not explained to your satisfaction. Don't hesitate to speak up, you know. So we have time, and I'm not planning on doing 120 slides in 120 minutes. So just in general, biologists collect a lot of data. Many people have said that biology is becoming a data-intensive science. And it seems to us, it's a faculty, that it's wise to give you some basic training in data skills as we send you out there in the world to become biologists or as biologists. We have lots of species, articles in scientific journals, genetic information like gene names, mutant phenotypes, locations of genes, linkage distance. Then we have all the data that comes from high throughput technologies, PCR, microarrays, DNA sequencing, more and more, many methods to collect genotype data. All of these data types have quality values frequently built right into the file format. Each of these different assay technologies has its own infrastructure. Some of them have been invented by companies, others are sort of a community product of the scientific world. But initially, when you're in the lab, you do an assay, you collect raw data in some form. It might be an image, it might be a numerical value, a trace file. If it's a commercial product, it may collect its data in a machine-specific binary format, readable essentially only to the engineers who've designed that machine. To share data in the scientific world, very frequently we use a text format. And why is text so broadly used? Well, first off, it doesn't require custom software to read text. You can read text on any computer with any sort of text reader. And text doesn't really go out of fashion. We can read ASCII text files that are, 40, 50 years old. We may have some issues with the media on which the file is contained, but the actual digital information is still readable. Nobody owns it. It's a community format. It's stable for long periods of time across different computing systems. It's relatively easy to communicate a text file among different people working on different computing systems. The World Wide Web is basically a text-based communication system. An HTML file is text. There may be some images, some other stuff that decorate it, but the fundamental exchange of information is a text-based format. So it's stable, it lasts a long time, and no one owns it. I think those are the key attributes. So text itself isn't really a format, it's more of an encoding. Just like HTTP, you know, isn't a website, it's just a way of transferring information and formatting it on the screen. So I'm going to go through several of these file formats today. These are just examples. I'm not expecting you to learn them off of this screen. But in each one of these cases, the text has additional attributes, such as a header line with a specific symbol. The lines may have a specific length. There may be tags that are associated with each line that tell you something about what information is present there. And I'm going to show you a few different ways that, a few different types of text formats that are in common use that I think you ought to know as you start wading through biology data. Before I do the specific examples, I want to explain this concept, which is pretty widely used, called a tag value pair. And whether you know it or not, you're relatively familiar with this because it's essentially the index card metaphor. You have a line, and that line contains data of a particular type. And either it's either formatted so that that line is known because it's the first or the fourth line of the file, or more frequently, it contains a little tag that says, this line is the address, this line is the annotation, this line is the author, etc. A nice thing about a tag that goes with the value is that they could be in any order, which is helpful, but even more helpful is that you can leave some of the tags out so that you can have a generic format that has many tags available and you only use the ones that you need for that particular data item. HTML is essentially that way. You have tags like bold and blinking and red and whatnot, and you don't have to use them, but the system recognizes a specific vocabulary of tags and it knows what to do with each one of them. Right, so this is a tag for a hyperlink, right? href tells the system a specific thing about the data that's about to follow that tag. H1 puts it as a large font, P is a paragraph tag. So we have tags like that for citations, we have tags for GenBank, we have tags for genome editing files. So another important structural concept is a database. And sometimes your mental concept of a database is a little amorphous, and so I want to create two rather solid metaphors, one of which is the index card file, and the other is the spreadsheet. And the index card file, you have to think of one that's like a Rolodex, right, where you have specific fields, name, address, phone number, email, you know, name of wife, number of kids, whatever you want to put on your Rolodex. But those fields are present on every card in the file. And you could fill out as many of those fields as you want for an individual contact, but they're consistent. And so you can sort of slide through the Rolodex by name, which is how they're probably indexed at the top of the tabs. A little more abstract, but probably more germane to what we're doing every day, is the spreadsheet, like an Excel sheet. And in this case, the columns represent the fields. the possible areas where we're going to enter information. And just like in the index card, everything that's entered in that column has to be of the same form. So you always want to put the email in the email address line of your index card. And you always want to put a primer sequence in the primer file of this column. The database becomes pretty unusable if you put sort of arbitrary things in the column. And so typically when you have a well-structured database, there's some sort of rule about uploading a well-formatted file. So we're going to talk about GenBank soon, and they have both automated and human curators to make sure that what goes into each column, each field of information, is correctly formatted. When it's correctly formatted, you have the power to search vertically through your database. So you can search for when there's a C in the HAP A field, which is meaningful. If you had to search the entire database for the character C, it becomes unmeaningful. Similarly, a SNP ID is only helpful in the SNP ID field, and we won't want to put it in the gene field, which is a little bit more like a free text. And it would, so I'll get to that in a second. So it's structured data. The fields are the columns. The rows are called records. So each index card, each contact, each gene in this case has a row. And some or all of those fields are filled out for that entry. And you can add more entries to the database just by adding more rows. The fields of the categories contain the same type of data. The records, another way to look at it is the record is an object. And all of the delimited columns of that object are information about that entry. So it's related information across fields that all connect to one entry. A record does not need to have data in every field. Okay. And again, going back to the previous slide, you can think of a record as a series of tag value pairs where the tags now are the headers for the columns. So gene is the tag, lymphocyte is the value in the first record. So a spreadsheet can be a database, but a spreadsheet is not automatically a database. Not every Excel file on your computer meets the rules of a database. Again, you want to structure your database as a spreadsheet, you would have tab delimited text. You would be sure that the columns are formatted as fields, the rows are records, and you enforce those rules. I very frequently deal with spreadsheets that are collected in the clinical world, doctors, people working at clinical labs, and they like to sort of type little annotations inside of the field. So, you know, they have a bunch of haplotypes, C, A, G, and then they say, you know, unable to obtain, or, you know, patient was sick today, or something like that. And that becomes unusable as a database because now you can't search for the letter C in this field because there's text that's formatted in different ways. So typically when you're submitting data to a public database, you have to go through a series of curation steps to make sure that the right type of data is present in every field. If you do have a properly formatted set of data, then you can do Boolean searches. So you can combine a search in one field with another search in another field. So, you know, where the species field is human and the gene is hemoglobin and the SNP is either an AT or a CG or something like that. So you can very powerfully sort through a very large database by targeting a search to have hits across multiple fields, you know, meaningful hits that are related to the content of each field. Oh, I didn't get my rest of my screen to show up properly. Oh well. So you can take an Excel file, save it as tab delimited, in which case you would just have the columns separated by tabs. It may or may not look beautiful on your screen, depending on how whatever software you're using to view the text spaces out the tabs, but a computer will read that file just fine. Also from Excel, you can save your columns separated by commas, which is called comma-separated values, or CSVs. I got to remember to fix that. Oh, there it is. I did it animated. I hate animations. Right, so there's your tab delimited text. In this case, I forced it to line up right. And there's your comma-separated text of the same thing. All right. I think that's sufficiently clear. Okay, so given the fact that we would like to use a text format to communicate biological data, we have to come up with some sort of convention. It's not really helpful and suitable for each person to design their own file format and save the data in some possible public location, like attached to a journal article or whatever, and have some little footnote about how their data is formatted, and then hope that somebody else who wants to study their data can learn their formatting system and write appropriate software to read the formatting system. And you wouldn't have to repeat that for every single publication, right? Because everybody has data and they have idiosyncrasies about how they want to format it. We need to have some sort of standard so that when you want to communicate genetic sequences, there's a standard format. Someone can write software and expect to be able to load data that's produced in different countries, people speaking different languages, et cetera. There's lots of things beyond genetic sequences. There's genotypes, there's taxonomy, any number of file formats, phylogenetics, proteomics, et cetera, et cetera. Each one of these areas has the task of establishing standards. Unfortunately, in the scientific world, there's not one authoritative standards body that sets all the standards for every kind of data. That's unfortunate. Instead, individual communities coalesce around different types of standards and enforce them more or less vigorously. I'll talk about some examples of that. So, since I'm most familiar with DNA sequences, I'm going to use that as an example. It's fairly intuitive that the four nucleotide bases can be abbreviated as four letters. So, you know, guanine is G, adenine is A, thymine, cytosine, etc. So we typically talk about DNA sequences as being GATC, and we assume that sometimes those sequences are double-stranded, like in the genome, and that the complementary sequence is present, but we don't have to type out the complementary sequence. It's just there by assumption. And we can get by with this for a little while as a way of talking about sequences. But computers are more finicky than that. They might want to know something about how many letters per line. Are carriage returns meaningful? Are spaces meaningful? How about numbers in the middle of the text file? What do they mean? Should the file have headers? What about metadata? Where does this sequence come from? Who's the author? When was it published? And then there's a variety of different kinds of text. What sort of text should it be? And then what about proteins? Should a protein sequence have a completely different format and a separate body of scientists setting international standards? Or should we create some variant of the DNA format that encompasses protein sequences? So we have a de facto standard for communicating both DNA and protein sequences. There are a number of other standards as well, unfortunately. There's not just one, there's many dozens. But the most common format for communicating DNA and protein sequence data is called the FASTA format. And it's not an acronym, really. It was created by William Pearson in 1985, which is, you know, ancient history or not so ancient, depending on when you went to college. So not so ancient for me. when he was writing a piece of software that he called FastA. And FastA is a fast aligner. So there you go. He wanted to line up two sequences, and so he needed a way for the computer to store those sequences and access them from data files. And he wanted it to be simple because computers in those days didn't have a lot of memory, so he didn't want to waste a lot of space on parts of the file format that were non-essential. So he came up with this idea that a sequence should have just one header line. And in that header line should be an identifier. It should be unique and unambiguous. But he didn't go any further than saying there will be a header line. And that header line will start with this greater than symbol. And it will contain some text. The first group of characters, the first word following the greater than symbol, is the sequence identifier. The rest of the header line is available for anyone to write anything they want. Individual software, individual databases make specific use of that header line, but different software and different databases will put different things in the FastA header. I sometimes get data from the Flybase, which is a Drosophila database, and they write enormous header lines. When it wraps on my screen, it might go 10 lines long. And they have all the database cross-references and the history of annotations and a ton of junk in that header. Other software is much more minimalist. It tells you maybe the sequence name, how long it is, whether it's nucleotide or protein. If your software recognizes this specific format, it may be able to parse this header line. But if not, it still knows that there's a header line, the sequence has this name, and the rest of the lines are DNA sequence. All other characters are part of the sequence. Most software ignores spaces and carriage returns in the sequence part itself. In other words, it doesn't matter how long the lines are and where you choose to wrap them, and whether you wrap them with carriage returns or not, whether you group the sequences in bunches of 10 or 20 or 50 bases and put a space between them, those characters are ignored. Some software ignores numbers inside, so like if your lines are numbered, it may be okay. Other software will glitch on that. It's not defined in the FastA format. Punctuation is also not defined. Some software uses dots, some use space, some use underscores inside the sequence. There is a set of well-defined ambiguity characters, characters where it's either a G or a C, either an A or a T, and those, again, can be read by most software. N is a nearly universal for unknown base. I can't think of any software that won't recognize that, but you guys could easily write some that fail to recognize an N or fail to count it properly. In addition to defining a format for a single sequence, Pearson also, at the same time, defined a format for a database. His database is what we call a flat file, meaning just a bunch of text, all in one file. And all he did was concatenate multiple FastA formatted sequences in one file. The way you tell sequences apart in a FastA file is that there is a carriage return followed by a new header. New header always starts with a greater than symbol, has some text, and then a carriage return. I intentionally grabbed this stuff from Flybase to show you the extreme of ugliness in a FastA file. And it wraps like this on my screen. And all of this from here to here is all one FastA file. And then when you get to the next greater than symbol, that's the start of the next file. These are ugly wraps and ugly indents that are created by PowerPoint when I paste it in. But you could take this sequence and paste it back into a text file, and it could be read by just about any software that recognizes FastA files. because FASTA files know to ignore tabs and carriage returns. That's part of the format. So, another thing here is I mentioned tag value pairs, and I mentioned a database that's defined by fields. This messy header from Flybase is actually a database defined only by them. And they use the semicolon as a field separator. And sometimes, but not all the time, they use a tag such as type and an equal sign and then a value. So type equals protein, loc equals X, ID equals FBPP, whatever, name equals this. Yeah, for most of them they have, but then over here they have GB protein semicolon instead of an equal sign. So they, you know, they have their own crazy rules. That's all I can say. And it works for them. They can read their own file format. And if you wanted to write a piece of software that could parse the header line of a Flybase entry, it's actually consistent. Okay, so that's a standard for DNA and sequence data. It's not the only one, but it is very widely accepted. No one would write any sort of commercial software or popular public website to deal with sequence data that could not read and write FASTA format. So you go to any public database, whether it's in Europe or Japan or the US or South America, and you know, if it contains sequence data, there's going to be a way to dump a FASTA file out of it, because that's the way they can ensure compatibility with the rest of the world. Okay, other areas of data, and I just listed a few off the top of my head here, such as genotypes and haplotypes, clinical records, gene expression values, genome annotation, protein structure, alignments, phylogenetic trees. Again, there's no single scientific body that rules over all of these things. Everyone has one or multiple international organizations that, to varying extents, try to create and enforce a standard file type to communicate the relevant information. So each one of these has its own backstory. I just said that. So each has its own peculiar history. There may or may not be a single home database for a particular type of information. Like when you're talking about DNA sequences, there's actually three home databases, but they all update each other, so they all have the same data. There's GenBank, Embl in Europe, and DDBJ in Japan. But they all communicate every day and update each other's data, although they do have a different accession numbers for the same file. But each one of them has a cross-reference field, so that when you're looking at an Embl field, you can see that the GenBank ID for this same sequence is such and such. So GenBank format is defined by the NCBI, which is part of the NIH, National Library of Medicine. So it's kind of like us. And this is a link to their definition of the GenBank format. And I'm actually going to show it to you in a couple slides, because I think it's important. There's a BED format that defines intervals on the reference genome. This was invented by Jim Kent in 1999 and is defined at the UCSC genome browser. And lots of other people now use that format. The GFF3 format is the product of a committee. And the committee, called the Sequence Ontology Group, maintains a website where they maintain a format for GFF3. There's probably going to be a GFF4, 5, 6, et cetera, because more and more information is being crammed into genome annotation, which is what GFF is all about, genome format file. FASTA and this other thing called FASTQ have no home. They're de facto standards that are maintained by sort of open lines of communication and just the default practices of software writers. There was actually a paper in nucleic acids research in 2010 listing all the different variants of the FASTA and FASTQ file formats that were in current use and some historical perspective on this. It's actually sort of sad and painful to read, but I gave you the link here. So when I'm working with a file format, I typically look and see if there is a file format definition for that file. And therefore, you know, are there things I could expect if I'm reading that format? Are there things I have to follow if I'm trying to create a file in that format? Very rarely, like as is the case for GFF3, someone will go to the effort of creating a validator. So you could take a file that you've written, run it through the validator, and it will tell you if your file is good. It might even give you valuable error messages and style points for, you know, how to make it better. That's not universal at all. That's like Lichtenstein. He's kind of a OCD kind of guy, so he made that up. Okay, so what about software? I mentioned frequently that we need file formats in order to exchange data scientifically, but also to exchange data between software, even on your own computer. Within a single software language, files are much more rigorously defined. And in that case, we usually call them data types. And we're going to be mostly in the Python world for the next few weeks. And so we're going to define some files formats as Python data types. And Python knows how to read FASTA, FASTQ, BED, GFF3, et cetera, because people have gone to the effort of writing Python modules that can read text in those formats, validate that it's correct, and then load it into Python in an even more rigorously defined way so that we know, you know, basically the same idea, tag value pairs, that we can access the data. And when we're looking inside of a specific field, we know in advance what should be there. Is it going to be a number? Is it going to be an integer or a decimal or a real number? Is it going to be text? Is it going to have more than one word in it? What's the alphabet that text, that's legal for the text in that field? Software really needs to know all that stuff before you go and do some advanced computing on that data and then generate a bunch of errors because, you know, you divided by zero or you divided by, you know, you divided an integer by a text word and gives you, you know, a useless result. So software needs to have its data much more rigorously defined than some of the definitions for these public file types, which have some wiggle room and some slack and some areas where you can write whatever you want. So you might have challenges. You might be downloading data from a public source that claims to be in a certain file format, but when you read it into a given piece of software, that software gives you a glitch, an error, which is actually better than reading that file format, having a silent error, and then giving you incorrect results. But since some of these softwares define their formats more rigorously and some people make more slack use of these public file definitions, we have a lot of problems in that area. Somewhere along here, I have a slide saying bioinformaticians spend a majority of their time fighting with file formats. And that's really what I mean, is getting a file that's supposed to be in a given format and trying to get another piece of software that's supposed to read that format to actually read it, correcting the errors as you go. Yeah?
So if you know that the file extension are the same, you have to change some kind of mode to execute the file using different software.
Depends. I mean, I can't begin to list all the errors that I've discovered or all the incompatibilities. I won't call them errors. All the things that one software blames on another software that wrote the file. You know, carriage returns aren't properly formatted, spaces are not allowed in file names. That's just trivial stuff, right? It goes on and on and on. We've had all those problems last week. This is an example of an area where there's no committee, no national, international standard. Every company does it different. Every website does it different. Every database does it different. Genotypes, SNPs. SNPs are variants, but they can be heterozygous or homozygous, right? So how do you code that? You could code it as C/C or C/G for heterozygous or homozygous, or you could code it as 0, 1, and 2, 0 presumably being homozygous wild type, 1 being heterozygous mutation 1, and 2 being homozygous mutation 1, assuming that there's only one possible variant that can occur at that base, which is this database over here, HapStat. So a horrible, horrible situation, and might get better because the NCBI is getting more enthusiastically into this area. They've had the dbSNP for a long time, and dbSNP is one possible format to encode a variant data, but it's not very compact. So if you have a machine that can measure thousands of variants in one sample all at once, you really would not want to be writing dbSNP output files for every single variant in every single sample. But there's a new database, ClinVar, where they are going to be collecting variants on lots and lots of people, and maybe that file format will get adopted by someone else. We'll see. So here's an area where there's no standard, there's no body, and every piece of software you get, every machine that you get that can generate some sort of genotypes is going to give you data in a different format. And there's probably not even going to be existing software to convert them among these formats. You're on your own. So much of the routine annoying work of bioinformatics means messing around with file formats to get them to work with various software, then messing around with the results produced by that software to get a useful summary. And that's some of the data skills that we're going to try and impart in this course. Okay, so in addition to your own experimental data, access to public data is essential. So, for example, reference genomes have become one of the most useful reagents that a biologist can access. So much of our lab experiments now assume the existence of a reference genome. You might have a microarray. That microarray assumes the knowledge of the sequences so that you can assay either their amount, if you're measuring gene expression, or their variations from a known sequence. And the microarray may even include known variants so that you can do microarray-based genotyping. If you're doing RNA-seq, you're assuming that you can quantify all the genes based on a database that contains the sequences of the transcripts. If you're doing variant searching, you're looking at a human genome and you're trying to find mutations, you're assuming that you know the wild type. Same goes for a lot of other technologies. So we have databases for genomes, for SNPs, genotypes, population sets, journal articles, hugely important. It goes on infinitely. Proteomics, lots of public databases in every field. Particularly fond of GenBank. It's sort of the godfather of public databases. It was one of the first to be well organized. It contains all the DNA and protein sequences described in the scientific literature or collected in publicly funded research. The reason it's so comprehensive is that both the journal editors and the funding agencies have agreed that to publish a paper or to get a grant, you have to agree to make your sequences public in a public repository. In the US, the official public repository is GenBank. In Europe, it's EMBL, and Japan has its own. So since scientists live on publications, all their work ends up in GenBank. Frequently, we have these large grants that go to organizations like Cancer Genome Atlas or the Human Genome Project, and a condition of that funding is that they will make their data available early. you know, maybe before even the project is completed, they'll be uploading data in tranches, you know, every 6 months or whatever, so that you can have access to this publicly funded data before it's been very thoroughly sliced and diced by the investigators who've created it. GemBank is a text file. We call it a flat file. It's also a relational database, but you could download the whole thing as a text file. It would be big. Well, it used to be, when I started in this field, that you could get it mailed to you on a CD every month. Then it was a DVD. Then it was a stack of CDs. Then they invented DVDs, and it went back down to one. And then it was a stack of DVDs. And then they stopped the mail service, at which point it was possible to download it. But then you started needing a bigger and bigger computer to hold the whole thing. We stopped keeping a full local copy of GemBank here in about 2005. So each submitted sequence is a record in that same tag value format that I was talking about before, or you could think of it as a spreadsheet, where each of the fields is a column, and the record is a row that has entries in each relevant column. There's actually a lot of columns that are not used. And weirdly, GenBank has subfields. So one field can have any number of subfields. So you can just think of that field as very big and extensible. Simple stuff. Like, obviously, a unique name, which we call a GemBank ID. Organism, date, author. It's sometimes useful to remember that GemBank is run by the National Library of Medicine. So the curators are librarians at heart. And so they like to organize things by author and date. They have plenty of really good bioinformatics software that searches by sequence, but when you get into the back end of the advanced query engine, you see fields that are more appropriate for a journal article, because they built PubMed, and then they built GenBank along similar lines. Super important is that each sequence has a unique identifier. It actually has several. We typically talk about the GenBank ID, or the accession number. But there's a couple of others. There's a locus. Right, so here's part of a GemBank file. I've put the tags, the field identifiers at the left here. And a lot of them are in blue, not all of them, apparently. So locus is this thing, SCU. The definition is a free text line. So the author of the sequence, the person uploading it, can put more or less anything they want in this text line. They have some guidelines, but because it's free text, they don't really check it very carefully. So there are an enormous number of typos and unusual spellings and different ways of putting dashes and underlines and spaces in the middle of names here. So when you do a text-based search of the definition line, you never know what you're going to get. You're going to miss some things, and you're going to hit some other things that you didn't mean to hit. So I don't recommend that. If you have a locus name and you search by that, you'll always hit exactly the one thing you were looking for. And then there's an accession number, which is the thing that people usually toss around. If you make a figure, it's nice to annotate with accession numbers or put them in the caption if it's just a few genes. Organism is defined. They actually have a taxonomy database. So when you're uploading, you can sort of do it in a pull-down list sort of way that it matches exactly the taxonomy that's known for this organism. There's authors of the sequence, and then there's also authors of a reference, which is optional. You don't have to have a published paper to load a GenBank sequence, but if you are loading a sequence that's associated with a published paper, they want it here. Some of that gets added automatically by the curators, but it's much better if the authors make the links themselves. Then we have this big field called features, which is sort of infinitely extensible, because the features are based on positions in the sequence, and you could put whatever you want here. They have certain available features, such as coding sequence. They have intron exon areas. They have just other features of interest, and you can make up your own features. They have like a little code for how to, you know, feature author generated. So you can decorate your sequence with whatever information you might want. You know, primer in our paper is located here, that kind of thing. All right, moving on. Example of a record in the dbSNP database. So this is just one base, right? This is a variant that was observed most likely by sequencing. And this is the record in dbSNP. So you could see why this format didn't really catch on for people who are making machines that are collecting genotypes on, you know, thousands of genotypes on hundreds of samples in a few minutes. So it's very lengthy. And the sequence itself, the SNP, is this Y here. That's a ambiguity code. But it's flanked by, I don't know, about 60, 80 bases on either side in the record. The reason for that is the records can now be searched by a sequence matching algorithm. But the downside is dbSNP is enormous if you download it as a text file. It's not just, you know, A, G, C, the way you might expect. It contains a ton of additional data. OK, I'm just going to repeat it again. Accession numbers are the way to communicate about reference sequences in databases. Species, gene name, function are too ambiguous and will not necessarily give you one and only one match. Accession numbers also refer to a particular entry added by a particular author. For example, human hemoglobin beta has been sequenced many times from many different individuals from many different studies. Which one are you talking about when you have taken that sequence and done something on it, designed a primer, whatever? You want to reference a particular accession number so someone else can reproduce your work starting with the same sequence that you're working with. Searching by gene names and keywords is doomed to failure. You will miss things that you're looking for and hit things that you're not looking for, because the free text in the definition line is mostly written by humans, and it's going to be full of errors. OK. GenBank is managed by NCBI, which is part of the Library of Medicine. I already said that. Interesting little tidbit. GenBank grows exponentially. Its doubling time is faster than the doubling time of computer processor speeds. So it gets more and more expensive in terms of computer hardware to maintain and search GenBank. Every year, the data doubles, but processor speeds only grow by, you know, a smaller amount, 60% or something like that. I think the doubling time of processor speeds is like 18 months. And also, this graph is showing it pretty nicely. The curve recently got steeper. It used to be this nice curve here where the doubling time was about a year. And we could live with that. Everyone could budget for it. Then in 2007, 2008, it got steeper. In 2010, it got steeper. In 2013, it got even steeper. So that's the growth of automated sequencing machines, Illumina, next-gen sequencing. And so, well, you know, GenBank is funded by Congress. They can maybe, probably keep up with this. At least we're paying to generate the data. We might as well pay to save it and share it with the research community, which is why we're generating it in the first place. But keeping a local copy becomes prohibitively challenging. And also, the GenBank people are constantly looking for data reduction strategies, you know, data compression, lossless or semi-lossy. What can we afford to throw away? What's redundant in the data that's not really scientifically valuable. So there's a lot of that going on. I won't get to that again in this course, but I have a course on sequencing where we'll talk about it in more detail. Okay, so I talked up till now strictly about flat files and storing data as text in tab delimited, tag value pairs. You'll also hear this term relational database, and I'm not going to go into relational database theory, but I am going to let you know that a relational database is actually a couple or a few different databases that intermix. They communicate with each other. And the good example of this is GenBank again. So GenBank has in one set of tables, and by table I mean, you know, rows and columns, it has DNA sequences. And in another set of tables, it has protein sequences, another set dbSNP, another set is taxonomy, all the scientific names of all the species. And there's some commonalities among these different tables. They all are text. They all have tag value pairs. They also all have accession numbers, authors, submission dates, and that sort of thing. But there's also fields that are relevant for one and not relevant for another. Proteins have phosphorylation sites. Genomes have transcription starts. Proteins don't. So it's better to have slightly different spreadsheets with different sets of fields for the protein and the DNA. But what if the DNA, what if the protein is an automatic translation of the DNA? That link should be maintained in the database. And that's a relational tag, a cross-reference. So the different tables are linked by what's called key fields. Those are the cross-references. So the protein will contain the accession number of the DNA from which it was automatically translated. And the DNA, if it is gene protein coding and there is an entry in the protein table, will contain a cross-link of a key for the accession number of the protein. Similarly, almost all, but not all, GenBank entries are related to published articles, because that's the motivation for why people put stuff in GenBank. So there will be a cross-reference between a sequence and a PubMed literature reference. Genetic diseases, polymorphisms, gene expression, chemistry, all of them have their own tables in GenBank. Okay, I'm going to skip that one. Most databases have a simple query engine. And you're all familiar with the ultimate simple query engine of the Google, right? Google has one line. You can type stuff and hit search. And it magically searches every field of everything to find that. You may or may not know that Google has an advanced query engine where you can target your query to lots of fields that Google actually maintains for every web page that it indexes. You could limit by language, when the page was last updated, only look in headers, only look in HTML files that have a certain extension, et cetera, et cetera. Only look for PDF files, only look for pages that have no annoying animations, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So, there's an advanced search that targets specific fields, which are, again, columns. In this case, the columns are indexed as part of the Google index that it builds as it crawls the web and devours information about all the web pages it reads. OK, so the GenBank has this query engine called Entree. And it also has a single query field that lets you search everything. Doesn't work quite so well as Google, but it does have this nice little pull-down field where you can say, I want to search a journal article, or I want to search a nucleotide sequence, or I want to search a protein sequence. So in that case, you're basically targeting one of the relational databases that has within it a table structure. But you're still searching kind of everything inside of that table. But if you go to the advanced query page of Entree, Then you can target specific fields, you can limit by language. Here again, it starts to look a little bit more like a reference librarian and a little less like a genomics tool. But nonetheless, you can search genes using this interface and limit, say, to a specific species or a file that was updated a certain way or just the RefSeq or a number of other things published in the last whatever. There's some clinical stuff down here that's not so relevant to us today. In addition to the simple interface and the advanced interface, a bunch of databases, including GenBank, have this thing called the web API, where you could send a specific query formatted in a certain way with your web browser or any other tool that chooses to communicate over HTTP, and the database will send you back its result. That result is formatted text. Usually it's HTML. Usually it's designed to be displayed in the web browser. But one of the things you could do is ask for a file in FASTA format from GenBank, or you could ask for the result of a search query in XML format. And then some piece of software on your computer might parse that data automatically, so you could do lots of queries and give yourself a process data result. So all these databases have ways of accessing them in an automated fashion. You don't have to go in with a web browser. So this thing is called a web API, which is one of the simplest types of programming for a novice programmer. And we'll play with that in a couple weeks. I was talking about this before. There are pre-computed relationships in the GenBank database. So that when one of the things you might want to know is, are there other sequences like this one? Since that question is asked often, rather than running the compute power to make those similarity searches, there's a link, a button that has a pre-computed search of other sequences like this one. Similarly, if there's a cross-link between a protein and a nucleotide sequence, there'll be a button for that. In the PubMed world, there's relationships between articles that share a lot of similar content, computed with a thing called mesh terms. In a simplistic view, Entree looks sort of like this, where you've got journal articles, nucleotides, proteins, genomes, and protein structures. But because there's so many different GenBank or NCBI databases, the reality looks a little bit more like this. Actually, this is a simplification too. There's probably 50 more NCBI databases that are sort of more obscure than these. The interesting thing about this database is that PubMed is the most intensely linked area. It's not DNA, it's not proteins, it's journal articles. If you think for a second, of course it's journal articles. That's what drives science, right? If you have a piece of data that you've discovered and you want to publish it, you have to put it in GenBank because the editors and your funding source demand it. Therefore, you'll have a PubMed article and a linked database entry. So sometimes it makes the most sense to start in PubMed and then move to protein, or then move to DNA, et cetera. This is an example of a simple query in nucleotides, where what you get is pretty unpredictable. I was looking for this BRI gene, but instead I got sarcoma-associated herpes virus, BRIK1 protein, and polycomb protein, et cetera, because they have those letters in the name. OK, I'm going to go more quickly through some other important databases, just as examples, not for you to memorize or anything like that. But we have databases of genomes, proteins, pathways, gene expression, variations, protein. And then I'm going to stop a little bit on biological function. So one of my most favorite databases is something of pretty recent origin, the UCSC Genome Browser, which was built in 1999 by Jim Kent and some other people at UCSC. They were trying to come up with an interface for the Human Genome Project, which was at that point a sort of unwieldy mess of files. And one of the things they did was they stitched them together using the metaphor of chromosomes. And they said, well, what if we just laid all the chromosomes end to end and we thought of the genome as being sort of horizontal so that we could go left to right across the genome. And then where we don't know exactly where things fit together, we'll just sort of put X's there. And then as we learn more and we build better and better versions of the reference sequence, we'll move pieces around or fill in those X's. And that metaphor turned out to be really powerful. So the metaphor looks something like this. So for any given chromosome, you can visualize an individual location, which is this little red bar. And at that red bar, we zoom in a little bit, and we're looking here at, it's not showing well. Some number of thousands of bases here. And then each one of these horizontal lines in various colors is a annotation, a set of positions on that genome. And annotated at this position on this genome is human hemoglobin beta, HBB. And this is annotated from several different databases. A bunch of human mRNAs from GenBank also line up at this position. There's also some known ESTs, some known polymorphisms from dbSNP. And we're throwing some computational information about conservation among different species. Going back a little bit, the way these annotations are displayed on the genome relates to this simple file format they call bed format. The simplest version just has a chromosome number, a begin and end position. So that is a little black bar that exists on the genome at a particular position. And depending on what that track represents, it annotates that position for that field. So you could be measuring conservation, you could be measuring GC content, you could be measuring the binding of a transcription factor, you could be measuring epigenetic histone modifications. Whatever it is, it's a position on the genome that has that thing. And then the file contains a bunch of different genome positions, as many as you want. Yeah?
Did you say already the number there is that starting from like zero?
Yes. Yes, so the chromosome is sort of arbitrarily defined to run horizontally, beginning at zero and ending at a few hundred million, however long that chromosome might be. And genes naturally are on both strands, so some genes go right to left and some genes go left to right. This gene is going right to left, right? It's going sort of backwards across the screen, and you can tell from these little arrow symbols. That's about the only way you can really tell here. This is a start position, and it's assuming that the chromosome is numbered from 1. Not from 0, by the way, from 1, first base. There's a slightly more complete bed format that includes things like color and places where the line gets thicker and thinner. Introns and exons have explicit fields that you can add to the bed line. So right here is a definition of the bed. So the first three fields, chromosome name, start, and end, are all that's required. So that gives you the minimal bed. And then there's however many more, 9 more optional fields. And I believe that the way it goes is that the fields are tab delimited. Yep, they're tab delimited. But if you want to use some of the later fields and not some of the intermediate ones, you have to put a dot in that field so the browser can count what fields your information is in. I don't know how many of them are required, if you can just use the 10th one and just have a whole bunch of dots, or whether you have to use them in groups. But in any case, the metaphor turned out to be really powerful, because you can add as many fields as you want horizontally down the page and just scroll up and down and see how these different genome annotations relate to each other. And they divide them up into things like mapping and sequencing, gene prediction, gene expression, regulation, comparative genomics, variation. The bar is pretty low to get a computationally predicted track of your own into the UCSC Genome Browser. Basically, you just need to publish a paper in some reasonable journal and produce a data track in the file format that they require, send it to them, tell them what category it ought to go in, and it could appear here. In addition to that, there is the option to produce a custom track where, again, you produce a bed file. You just go to the browser somewhere around here. I clipped it off. And it says load custom track, and it will visualize your track in the context of everything else that's going on in the browser. That's just for you, but you can save a URL and send it to someone else, and they can visualize your data just the way you've set it up. So a lot of people use UCSC to visualize data in the context of the genome. There's some limitations on how many gigabytes of data you can load, in a reasonable amount of time. So it's not so handy for sequencing data, but it's very handy for, say, summaries of a ChIP-seq experiment where you want to see where the transcription factor binds in relation to where the genes are. Okay. Ensemble has its own browser. It has different features than UCSC. I'm not going to go into details, but roughly similar and complementary. I found it a little harder to use, but they have more genomes. So sometimes if you want to look at an obscure species, it might be here. Their pipeline is a little more automated, so they're capable of processing newly published genomes and loading them in here considerably faster. I'm going to skip over this one. There's a microarray database in NCBI called GEO, which has gene expression experiments and also RNA-seq experiments now. You can browse an experiment by keywords like prostate cancer, that sort of thing. Or you could browse a particular gene and say, show me all the experiments where this gene was found to be differentially expressed. And now limit that by experiments that have at least two replicates. And then limit that to human. And so there's a reasonable interface to hundreds of thousands of gene expression experiments. I already talked about the SNP database of polymorphisms. This is very big for human. They have many millions of variants, although you could never say that it's comprehensive, because every individual has a few completely novel variants of their own. So it grows, but we've kind of reached the point of diminishing returns where it's growing more slowly. We're finding new variants a little more slowly than we used to be. NCBI also has its own genome browser. It's incredibly clunky after you've seen how elegant UCSC is. I can't think of any reason to ever use it. There's a database of pathways, which is extremely important because we're generating big data sets, gene lists, experiments that find a group of genes in some way. They are co-regulated in a gene expression experiment, or they're co-precipitated with a factor. So like, say this transcription factor binds to all of these genes, and so they're part of a pathway. So it's very nice to be able to lay over a diagram of a pathway and say, yes, this is where the genes in my experiment fit in. I'm gonna talk more about this in a second, but this is the KEG, Kyoto Encyclopedia of Genes and Genomes, where they've basically taken all the biochemical pathways that we know about, as well as some of the regulatory pathways. And first of all, they've mapped them out. In this case, they've added EC numbers for enzymes as well as genes. But they've also made it added a third dimension, which is genomes. So you can click on a given enzyme and then see all the genomes for which this enzyme has been identified. So any genome which has been completely sequenced and proteins have been predicted and this enzyme has been found will now be available in this database. Yeah?
Is this part of the relational database?
It's not part of NCBI. It's in Kyoto, actually in Japan. So there is a KEG file in UCSC, but it's a very tiny subset summary of the data. So frequently you need to go there. So they have some sort of more advanced files by subscription. Some of them cost, but
this is a part of the Japanese relational.
No, it's really a standalone thing. Oh. There's just it's one scientist at Kyoto University who does this thing, and it just turns out to be really useful. And people reference it all the time. It's one of the sort of, one of the well-established and sort of acceptable ways of annotating a genome is to say, I found all the KEG pathways in my genome. Yeah?
I may have missed it, but what do those numbers represent again?
Those are EC numbers. They are enzymes. These are enzymes that have a known chemical property. And while it's not necessary that the protein structure is known, but we know what protein does that reaction. And there's probably some biochemical kinetic information about that enzyme. So yeah, so it's a well-known enzyme, and we know exactly what biochemical function it does. It's a ADP phosphorylase, that sort of thing. So here I am zooming in a little bit on the citrate cycle. We're looking at phosphenylpyruvate and glycolysis, et cetera, et cetera. And then there's also this sort of acyclic graph where you can look at a pathway and then the enzymes that are in that pathway. And then for that given enzyme, you could look at all the species for which that enzyme is known and available as a sequence. Cross-referencing back probably to a protein database. Another similar pathway-oriented database is called Biocarta. This one has more of an emphasis on regulatory pathways, but it also has biochemical pathways. There's a database of protein-protein interactions, which tends to generate SNARDs like this because there's too many protein-protein interactions. But it can be an additional piece of evidence. You know, when you're postulating that two transcription factors co-regulate at the same position, you can mine this database to see if there's experimental evidence that those two proteins are interact and bind with each other under some conditions. That's what this is called, the bind network. All right, the last one that I want to spend a little time on is called genome ontology. KEG is one attempt at connecting a mess of information, like a genome, with biological information, like functions. Genetics is messy because when you start talking about a function in what organism? Is something that should come to mind, right? People do a lot of genetic work on fruit flies. Other people work on E. coli. There's research on humans, on mice. So a given gene or protein may be studied extensively in one system. And those investigators will give it a name that makes sense to them, like Sonic Hedgehog or whatever. And somebody else is working on a completely different system, and they have a protein they are interested in or a gene, and they give it a different name. Eventually, the two read papers from each other, or somebody does a connection, and they discover that they're actually working on orthologs, you know, two versions of the same protein in different species. So whose name wins out, and what's the actual function of this protein? If someone wants to annotate in the third species what the function of this protein is. So this has been a problem for a while, and now that we're able to generate lots of complete genomes, we have a challenge of annotation. Fortunately, we actually came up with an international consortium that produced a usable solution to this problem, which is called the genome ontology, or gene ontology. They have classified all of the well-studied proteins in the well-studied species, particularly in fruit fly and mouse, where lots of mutants are known. And then by extension to a bunch of other species that have fully sequenced genomes, like human and C. elegans. Each gene, or protein really, because protein is the true functional element that generates a phenotype, has three different categories of annotation. So everything is annotated in these three different fields. There is a molecular function field, which, you know, talks about a specific task. This directly correlates to the EC number, the enzyme, the biochemical function. But, you know, there's also biochemical functions like pore protein, which won't show up very well in KEG because it's not connected to something else. So there are structural molecular functions as well as enzymatic ones. And then there's a biological process, right? It's not just a pore, it's a gated ion channel. Okay, that is talking about what it does as in a biological sense. And then the third aspect is cellular location. Where is it in the cell? There's a finite number of cellular locations or subcellular locations, but you could probably list more than you think when you start going on about it. You know, endoplasmic reticulum, nuclear envelope, attached to the ribosome, et cetera, et cetera. So another aspect of this is that a protein may, in addition to receiving annotation in those three distinct categories, a protein may have multiple functions, either because it's in several pathways doing similar things, or it may truly be a bifunctional protein that does two almost unrelated tasks. It may be a receptor at the cell surface, and it may also be a nuclear regulator that, you know, it picks up a ligand, then it migrates in, or it turns around and it phosphorylates something as well as being a receptor. So those tasks are related in a biological sense, but when you get down to very discrete hierarchical descriptions, it needs to be described in several different ways. So this guy is both a signal transducer and a transporter. And it has these two slightly different hierarchies that end up pointing to the same function. So they call this an acyclic graph. So things don't just map in one place. They could have several different higher and lower level mappings. But there's some interesting mathematical ways to traverse a graph like this. So you get a group of proteins or genes as a result of an experiment. They're co-regulated, or they were bound by an antibody or something like that. You have an output of your experiment is a gene list. Now you take your gene list and you apply it to this graph, and you can make a fairly simple statistical statement and say, is this gene list enriched for a particular functional category at a high or a low level? In other words, do I hit a particular function more often than I would expect by chance for a list of genes drawn randomly for the genome? If yes, then I have identified the biological function that was being regulated and during the process of generating this group of genes that I've produced experimentally. This turns out to be an extremely productive way of functionally annotating a wide range of different experiments, and you'll see it in papers everywhere. Okay, general strategies for databases. I'm just about done here. This is not limited to biology. Use specific accession numbers to search databases whenever possible. If you don't have an accession number and you need to make keyword-based searches, start broad and then add additional keys to narrow so you can see what you're missing. You know, what's the whole universe of hemoglobin, human hemoglobin, hemoglobin beta, etc. Try variants of spelling. Search all relevant databases. When you're searching GenBank, you may not realize there's additional information in FlyBase or the Human Genome Disease Database or something like that. And be persistent, okay? So just in general, this is what we're talking about. You're going to do this over and over when you do work with biodata. You find the data, download, reformat, run analysis, collect the results, share. Alternately, you collect samples, run analysis, filter the data, run analysis software, publish and share. And they're cyclical, right? You generate data, you share the data, you take data from other people's experiments, combine it with your own, generate new information. So this is what we did today. We talked about text formats, formatting tag value pairs, database concepts, FASTA format, BED format, some examples of databases, and the genome ontology. Okay. Next lecture on Thursday, we're starting with Python. If you want to get ahead of the game, you can go on the website and follow some instructions for how to install Python on your computer. Homework today is a scavenger hunt across some of these databases that I've described, so you get a little bit familiar with them. That's all I've got.